subject from a rather different point of view, I suppose. As a celibate monastic for 40 years. But then my assignment was different too. The script I was given was spiritual friendship, which may be different or the same. Let's explore. Yeah? So, being traditionally trained, I would start at the beginning with definitions, and the idea of spiritual friendship from a Buddhist perspective is the Kalyana Mitra, or the good friend, the person who takes you in good directions, wholesome directions, healthy directions. So a spiritual friend is someone who teaches us, helps us to become a better person than we are. So this can be anyone, because sometimes it can even be the reverse, by bringing us to a place of anger or greed or desire or attachment. It can also teach us something about ourselves. But lasting spiritual friendships generally are opportunities for practicing patience and love in all situations. So I think in Hawaii this is what we call aloha, which is bringing love to every possible situation, to every person, not only to humans but to other animals as well, and all of, well, I was going to say creation. That's not really a Buddhist concept, but let's say creation, all of creation. Everything is out there. So when it comes to romantic relationships, I think we come into also the problem of defining terms. Because in Tibetan and most Asian languages, the idea of love has nothing at all to do with romantic attraction or sexuality. It's a totally different concept. The idea of love, of loving kindness, is wishing all beings to be happy. And it's a practice, it's a meditation practice. It's one of the four divine abidings. Loving kindness, compassion, joy, equanimity. Right? So the problem with romantic attachments or attractions is that they're not always purely loving, right? Romantic attachment or attraction often has a large measure of desire in it, or attachment, which can mess everything up, and usually does, right? So. Whereas loving kindness is purely about wishing others to be happy, with no thought of what's in it for me. What am I going to gain from this? It's not a business transaction. We love all sentient beings equally. That's the ideal, and we work toward that as a practice. So not differentiating between my partner and someone else. It's equal love for all sentient beings. And sentient beings means all beings with consciousness. So not carrots, not cabbages, not cauliflowers. Though by the time Buddhism gets to China, sometimes they include the grass and whatever it's, you know. But in India, it was sentient beings, meaning beings with consciousness, because the idea is for conscious evolution. In order to become liberated, a liberated consciousness, you have to have a consciousness to start with. So carrots can't do that, cauliflowers can't do that, can't become Buddhas. we have to start with consciousness, which is the trait of all animals, even down to the insects. Yeah? So this concept is really rather mind-blowing. The idea of generating loving kindness for all sentient beings means we're going to love a cockroach as much as we love our mother or our father or our sister, our brother, our teacher, our lover, or whatnot. Now that is, wow, mind-blowing, right? But that's what the Buddhists are going for, I mean, ultimately, is that an enlightened being, an awakened being, would generate loving kindness for all living beings, no matter how rich they are or poor they are, whether they're male or female, what caste they are, what color they are, or even what form they take, whether animal or human, another kind of animal, like a human animal. It would be equal loving kindness for all. So they do this in meditation practice. So we actually rehearse generating loving kindness equally for the friend, the enemy, and the stranger. And it's interesting to note that the stranger is in, the enemy is in the middle. So by enemy, it doesn't mean, you know, somebody that you wish dead or something. It means the people that are giving you the most trouble. They're making life difficult for you. They're bothering you. And making life unpleasant. So to try to sit down in the morning and visualize one's loved one, a loved one, better maybe not a romantic partner, because that can get complicated. It would be a loved one, an enemy, and a stranger. So someone on this side that is very dear to us, that we care very much for, someone who's been so kind to us and helpful to us and so forth. In the middle, someone who's harmed us, who's cheated us, who's lied to us, who's betrayed us or whatnot. And then the stranger is someone that we've never even met before. It's people we pass on the street every day, we couldn't care less about, right? We don't even notice them. So we consciously generate from our heart of feelings of great loving kindness to each one of these beings, who of course are only symbols of all of humanity or all of sentient beings. But by personalizing them, then we get specific and we get practiced at generating loving kindness for all three equally. And loving kindness, as I mentioned, is something without any expectation of return, right? We're very good at loving people who are lovable, right? But this is learning to be loving to people who are nasty, who are rude, who are despicable even. I won't mention names, but it's in the news, so. So actually, I remember one time when Baby Bush was in office. You know, at that time, that was like the worst thing that ever happened. I mean, little did we know. Things were going to get much worse. But on Maui, they decided that instead of sending bad thoughts to Baby Bush, they would send loving kindness to him. Because by sending rude thoughts, they were actually, in a way, empowering that kind of negativity in the universe. And it really changed things on Maui. I mean, Dennis Kucinich even won the primary, you know, and he was like a radical progressive, which, I mean, he hardly won anywhere, but on Maui he won because people's hearts were just open. They were full of love, and they were following through on that, you see. So I think that, I mean, if we can send loving kindness even to the people who are mean and nasty and, you know, actually threatening the very foundations of human existence, then maybe we can turn things around. You know, if we send hateful thoughts to these people, obviously we're only creating more hate in the world, and that's not going to help anything. That's not going to help anybody. So in a way, it's very empowering because it helps us also to get over our anger, to get over our feelings of hatred for the people that bother us and just completely transform that into its opposite, which is always love, which is always the answer. I love the signboard downstairs. love is always the answer. Signs in India are so great. like talk less, work more. All these great signs, yeah. But it's like the reminders, it's kind of wake-up calls that help us. And if we have to post them on our bathroom mirrors, that's fine, you know, I mean, whatever helps. So this would be the sort of standard Buddhist approach. And personally, I find it very helpful because we all run into nasty, mean people. And what are we going to do about it? Are we going to make ourselves miserable and carry it around and play the same record all day, every day, sometimes for years, sometimes for our whole life? What's the point of that? It's totally unproductive, and we're just like bashing ourselves over and over again. They're not doing anything. They forgot all about it. But we are torturing ourselves by harboring these negative emotions. So we've all been in relationships, I'm sure, that have been painful, but and that's part of, yeah, that's part of life, okay? But we don't need to carry it around with us. We can get free from it. That's what liberation means. It's not a place in the sky. I mean, nirvana sounds like a place, a destination, like a vacation destination. But in fact, it's a freedom. It's a freedom from these negative emotions, or unwholesome, destructive emotions. It's the way the Dalai Lama is translating this word, kleshas, right? Destructive emotions. So when we become free from destructive emotions, we are liberated. And it can happen this very moment, right? It can happen moment to moment, which is the whole idea. The whole idea of momentary awareness, which is why, you know, creating intentional communities like you're doing is so important, because it creates a space for that kind of spiritual development or mental cultivation, you can say, where you don't have too many nasty people around. I mean, I didn't meet any yet. So, you know, everyone is sort of like helping each other along on the path, which is a wonderful thing. And that's what we mean by spiritual friendship. Yeah? So loving friendships. And sometimes this can also be a kind of trust between one another, that we can help point out where we might be like missing the point. Now that's maybe a more advanced level. That might be part of the spiritual friendship or partnership sort of thing. It should be mutual, because otherwise if we point out each other's failings, it can get kind of creepy and annoying. But sometimes when people even suggest that we might be doing something more, like talk less, you know, we waste so much time talking. And our mouth is the source of so many problems. We hurt people all the time, knowingly or unknowingly, with our speech. So the Buddhists talk about wholesome actions of body, speech, and mind. And of course, the speech and the physical actions emanate from the mind. So the first thing we need to do is to clean up our mind, purify our minds. But then also we can help it along by watching our actions of speech and our actions of body as well. That's why we sort of line up our little shoes at the door. It's a kind of a discipline. It's a practice, you know, of being careful of our actions. It's a silly thing, but it's very significant, yeah? And right speech is like that too. Being kind, you know, addressing each other in a friendly way. Bodhisattvas are always friendly, you know. They always greet people in a friendly way. Everyone, of all backgrounds, all stations in life. And that's challenging, but it's such a beautiful opportunity to, right? So to express love through our thoughts, our speech, and our actions in everyday life. So that brings it off the cushion into everyday life, every action of everyday life. So I thank you all for being spiritual friends. And it's a wonderful thing that you've got going here. My, it's quite rare in the world. And I wish you well and hope you all become awakened soon. Thank you so much.